James Hudson Taylor was born at Barnsley, Yorkshire, England, in 1832. Known simply as Hudson, he sensed by the time he was 17 years old that God was calling him to be a missionary in China. He prepared himself by reading books on China, analyzing the Chinese Gospel of Luke and studying medicine, and living by faith in England before going to China. 4 years of his first term of service were spent in Southeast China and was under the Chinese Evangelization Society. In 1858, in Ningbo, he married Maria Dyer, who was a faithful helpmate until her death in 1870. Although forced to return to England in 1860 because of poor health, Taylor had a continuing concern for the millions of Chinese living in provinces where no missionary had ever gone. In 1865, he summed up his growing vision in a book entitled China's Spiritual Need and Claims. The same year, with great faith but limited financial resources, he founded the China Inland Mission. Its goal was to present the gospel to all the provinces of China. Beginning in 1866 with a group of 22 missionaries, including the Taylors, the mission grew rapidly in numbers and outreach. By the time of Taylor's death in 1905, the China Inland Mission was an international body with 825 missionaries living in all 18 provinces of China. There were more than 300 stations, more than 500 local Chinese helpers, and 25,000 Christian converts. Taylor stamped his own philosophy of life and faith on the China Inland Mission. Number one, sole dependence on God financially, with no guaranteed salary. Close identification with the Chinese and their way of life. Administration based in China itself, rather than in Great Britain, an evangelical, non-denominational faith, and an emphasis upon proclaiming the gospel as widely as possible through all of China. With heavy administrative responsibilities, Taylor spent as much time out of China as in, traveling to many countries to make China's needs known and to recruit new missionaries. Although often absent from China, Taylor kept in close touch with his many missionaries and, where possible, continued to engage in missionary activity. He played a prominent part at the General Missionary Conferences in Shanghai in 1877 and 1890. He retired from administration in 1901, died in Changsha, Hunan in 1905, and was buried in Zhengshang, Jiangsu, China. Following is the story of his life lived in faith in God, as written by Phyllis Thompson. Hudson Taylor, God's Venturer, The Amazing Life of the First Missionary to China's Interior, by Phyllis Thompson. Chapter 1. The Last Silver Coin. Past 10 o'clock on a dark night, the raggedly dressed man accompanying him was a complete stranger to 19-year-old Hudson Taylor, who fingered a silver coin to make sure it was still in his pocket. He looked around him rather apprehensively. He had been along these poor, narrow streets before. Even in broad daylight, they were not inviting. Now, with street lamps flickering feebly on the corners of dark alleys and suspicious-looking people slinking into doorways, the neighborhood looked anything but safe and respectable. It was certainly not a place one would choose to walk in with ragged strangers after dark. But, after all, if he was going to China, he must get used to it. So he went on. "Why didn't you ask a priest to come and pray with your wife?" he asked his companion, rather glad to hear the familiar sound of his own voice. The man had come to young Taylor with the story that his wife was dying. "Will you come and pray for her soul?" Hudson Taylor had readily agreed. Now, however, he was beginning to wonder. The man was evidently a Roman Catholic. If his wife were indeed dying, why had he not obtained the services of a priest in this Irish quarter of Hull? Why come to a Protestant? The man explained. He had been to the priest. The priest, however, had demanded money before rendering his services, and as he and his family had no money left at all, money for a prayer was quite out of the question. Starving. Hudson fingered the coin uneasily. It was all he had. Apart from two bowls of porridge in his lodging, he had neither food nor money. He could scarcely be expected to part with the one remaining coin. He felt unreasonably annoyed with the man and reprimanded him for having allowed things to come to such a pass. Why had he not gone and asked for help? A dying wife and a starving family and doing nothing about it, indeed. I went, replied the man dismally. They told me to come back tomorrow morning at 11, but my wife, she'll be gone before morning, I'm fearing. Hudson's heart was touched. His own position had seemed precarious enough, but how much worse was the lot of his companion? If only he had two coins, he thought to himself, how gladly would he have given him one? The man turned suddenly out of the street and into a dark courtyard. Hudson had been there before. He remembered the last occasion very distinctly. He had been buffeted and pommeled by the indignant slum dwellers who had torn up the tracks he gave them. If ever he showed his face again, let him beware. The priest with his crucifix and prayers to Mary was welcome, but not a young English Protestant preacher. Hudson had departed with what dignity he could muster, little thinking he would ever be invited to return. And as he felt his way up a rickety flight of stairs in one of the tenement houses, he sincerely hoped that his presence would not become widely known. He was quite relieved when they reached the top of the stairs and he heard his companion open a door. They had reached their destination. What a sight met his eyes! The dim light from a cheap candle revealed bare boards, curtainless window, a room almost without furniture. On the floor in a corner, lying on a straw mattress, was a thin, exhausted woman, and beside her, a baby not 2 days old. Standing or lying on the floor were four or five other people, children in ill-fitting clothes, without shoes or stockings, who looked toward their father and the stranger he had brought with large, listless, hungry eyes. Hudson stood silently in the room, conscious of his one coin. Oh, if only it were in two separate pieces, he thought. Certainly he would immediately produce one and give it to these poor people. It was no use wishing. He pulled himself together, remembered that he was a preacher and intended being a missionary, and decided he must tell these people about God. You know, things are very bad for you just now, he faltered, but you must not be cast down. We have a Father in heaven who loves us and cares for us, and if we trust him, the words seemed to stick in his throat. Hypocrite. Something inside him seemed to be saying, telling people about a kind and loving Father in heaven, and not prepared to trust him yourself without your money. Hudson gave up trying to preach. The family looked at him in silence as he stood there before them in his long-tailed coat and wearing real leather shoes and with a top hat. What if his clothes were getting threadbare and his shoes needed mending? Compared with them, he appeared wealthy. How were they to know he only had one coin left in the world? Hudson felt very depressed indeed. Oh, if only he had more, he would give them. He really would. He turned to the man and said, "You asked me to come and pray with your wife. Let us pray now." It would be easy to pray, he thought, as he knelt on the bare floor, but it was not. No sooner had he commenced, "Our Father who art in heaven, Then that accusing voice within said again, "That coin in your pocket." He pressed through his prayer, feeling more and more miserable, and then rose to his feet. As he did so, the man said to him in desperation, "You can see what a terrible state we're in, sir. For God's sake, help us." Poor Hudson. There was nothing else to do now. He remembered suddenly something he had read often enough in the Sermon on the Mount. "Give to him that asketh of thee. Give." Slowly he put his hand in his pocket. The coin, all of it, would have to go. "You may think I'm well off," he said to the man as he handed him the money. "But, as a matter of fact, that's all the money I've got in the world." Surprisingly, he began to feel quite cheerful. "But what I've just been telling you is true, you know. God really is a father, and we can trust him. I can trust him." And he realized he could. He found himself speaking with great assurance and confidence about trusting God, now that the money was out of his pocket and in the man's. He was amazed at the difference it made to his feelings. He was positively buoyant. He and the family parted with mutual expressions of goodwill. He made his way down the rickety stairs and out into the courtyard, walking home with his head in the air, coattails flapping jauntily, singing at the top of his voice without a care in the world. And when he reached the small room in Drainside where he was lodging and prepared to eat his last but one bowl of porridge, he felt as happy as a king. An interesting thought occurred to him as he sat there. He remembered that he had read somewhere that he that giveth to the poor lendeth to the Lord. It put that money in quite a different light to feel that, having given it to poor people, he had lent it to God. The idea of lending God money might seem rather startling, but as it was in the Bible, he knew it was all right. So when he knelt to pray before going to bed, he mentioned the matter of the loan, requesting that it might be replaced soon. Otherwise, he would have no dinner the next day. The following morning, he arose as usual and looked at his last bowl of porridge. A hard day's work lay before him, and while one bowl of porridge was enough to start on, it was scarcely enough to continue on. When would God repay that loan? He sat down and commenced eating. The postman's rat-a-tat was heard on the front door, but he paid little attention, since he rarely received letters on Monday mornings. Within a few seconds, his landlady appeared at his door. "Here's a little package for you, Mr. Taylor," she said cheerfully, holding it toward him in her apron, for her hands were wet. "Oh, thank you," replied Hudson, rather surprised. He took it from her and looked at it. It was addressed to him all right, but he did not recognize the writing. The postmark was blurred, so that did not help him either. He decided to open it. Slitting the envelope, he drew out a sheet of paper. Inside was a pair of kid gloves. "Whoever is sending me kid gloves," he thought, mystified. Something fell out. It was a very small object, and it gleamed. He stooped to pick it up. It was a gold coin. He stared at it in amazement, looked through the paper wrapping for a letter, scanned the handwriting and the postmark for a clue as to who had sent it. All in vain. He never discovered where it came from. At that moment, he did not really care. As far as he was concerned, it had come straight from heaven. It dawned on him that not only had his silver coin been returned, but 10 times more. Suddenly, he laughed out loud. "That's good interest," he exclaimed jubilantly. "Ha, ha! Invested in God's bank for 12 hours, and it brings me this. This is the bank for me." End of chapter 1. Chapter 2, Drainside. Drainside Hall, where Hudson Taylor had come to live, was so called for the reason that it was beside a canal, But to the people living in the rows of tiny cottages built on either side of the narrow ditch, it was just a drain. Very convenient it was, too, to the inhabitants of those cottages. Opening their front doors and throwing hard, they could dispose of all their rubbish without giving themselves any further trouble. Dirty paper, cabbage leaves, potato peelings, and rotten vegetables floated about on the water, providing admirable targets for street urchins. And if the drain exuded unpleasant odors and provided a danger after dark to those who emerged unsteadily from the public house opposite to which Hudson lived, its advantages as a dustbin more than compensated. To Hudson, the contrast between this poverty-stricken, unattractive area and the beauties of the Yorkshire town from which he had come was sharp indeed. How different, too, was his shabbily furnished little room from the cozy, comfortable home over his father's drugstore in Market Square, Barnsley. The warm parlor behind the store, with its gaily colored china and sparkling glass, its large bookcase and comfortable couch and chairs, seemed a palace to the little room with a bed in one corner and a table and a couple of chairs. It was lonely, too, eating his limited meals in solitary state, instead of sitting down to a well-spread table with his parents and two chattering younger sisters. He enjoyed teasing his sisters with their corkscrew curls and frilly frocks, and he missed them, especially Amelia. But it was in order to get accustomed to loneliness and hardship that he had come here, and he was determined to stay. It was part of his preparation for living in China. Ever since the December evening, more than a year previously, when he had heard a voice saying to him, "Go for me to China," he had known that he must go. He was praying at the time he heard that voice, and although China had not been in his thoughts, the command was so clear and unmistakable that he had no doubt it was from God. It was because of his determination to obey that he had left his congenial home at Barnsley to come and work for a doctor in Hull. A little medical knowledge and experience would be useful in a strange land, and this move to Hull was but the first step in his journey toward that empire of the East. Not only was he anxious to gain medical knowledge for life as a missionary in China, that was a small matter compared with another question which constantly confronted him. He knew no one in China, and he was going alone. Was his faith in God strong enough for him to go to a strange land and face difficulties and dangers hitherto unknown? "When I get to China," he thought, "I shall have no claim on anyone for anything. My only claim will be on God. What if my faith is not the right sort? Suppose my prayers do not work." And the more he thought about it, the more he realized that he must learn to move men through God by prayer, even before he left England. To move men through God by prayer. The thought gripped him. Could it be done? He wanted to find out. In a very simple, natural way, the opportunity was presented to him through his employer. Dr. Robert Hardy was a friendly, kind-hearted, vigorous man with a never-failing fund of good humor. It was said he made people laugh so much they were cured of half their ailments without any medicines. With a large practice and many claims on his time, he was too busy to attend much to business details, and one day he said to his young assistant, "Taylor, please do remind me when it is time for me to pay you your salary. I'm so busy, you know. I'm quite likely to forget." He did forget. The time came to pay Hudson and nothing was said. A day or two passed and still no references was made to salary. Hudson was faced with two alternatives. He could ask the doctor for the money, or he could ask God. And remembering that when he got to China, he would have no one to ask but God, he decided to ask him now. That was why he was down to his last silver coin on the Sunday night when he gave it away to the starving family. Little wonder that when the gold coin fell out from the mysterious packet the next morning, he laughed aloud for joy. He had taken a risk to find out whether it worked, this idea of trusting God. And it had worked. Right in the nick of time, the money had come, and God alone knew from whom. Hudson certainly did not. All he knew was that he had not gone without a meal through trusting God, although it had looked very much as though he might. He felt like Elijah must have felt when the ravens arrived with his dinner. "It works, it works." Hudson went forth from his lodging, gold coin in pocket, lighthearted and jubilant. Trusting God worked. Obeying God worked. It was wonderful, stimulating, exciting. However, he realized that his money would not last forever. The main problem still remained, the payment of his salary. The cheerful, busy doctor might go on for months without remembering it. And the question was, would God remind him? Daily, Hudson prayed that the doctor might remember, then went cheerfully on with work and study, confident that something would happen. A week passed, and his money was diminishing slowly. His rent made quite a hole, but he had sufficient to last him until Saturday. But after that... Saturday came. The doctor said nothing. The day wore on. By 5 o'clock, all the patients had been attended to, and the doctor came into the dispensary where Hudson was, and sitting down in his armchair, started to talk. Evidently, he had no thought of the salary. Hudson, carefully watching a mixture in a pan, made no reference to it. Then quite suddenly, the doctor said, "By and by, Taylor, isn't your salary due again?" Hudson gasped. After all, it was all right. Once more, when down to his last coin, the necessary money was coming. He gulped once or twice before replying quietly, "Yes, as a matter of fact, it was due 2 or 3 weeks ago." "Oh, I am so sorry," exclaimed the doctor. "Why didn't you remind me? You know how busy I am. I do wish I had thought of it a little sooner, for I sent all the money I had to the bank only this afternoon. Otherwise, I would pay you at once." Poor Hudson. The sudden dashing of his hopes was almost too much. It was as though a bucket of icy water had been thrown over him. Fortunately, the concoction in the pan boiled up, and he rushed with it from the room, glad for an excuse to get away. When alone, he threw himself on his knees. His disappointment was so great he could scarcely pray. What his prayer lacked in coherence, however, it made up for in earnestness, and after a while he calmed down. Indeed, somewhat to his surprise, he found himself feeling quite cheerful again. God would certainly work for him, he thought hopefully, and although he had no money to pay his landlady when he returned to his lodging, even that knowledge did not unduly depress him. It was late when he prepared to leave the dispensary. The hands of the clock stood at about 10 minutes to 10 when he started to put on his overcoat. "Well, my landlady'll be in bed by the time I get back," he thought, "so I shall not have to see her this evening and tell her I cannot pay the rent this week. That's good." He walked over to the gas bracket, preparing to turn it off, when he heard the sound of footsteps outside. It was the doctor, and he was laughing heartily, as though greatly amused. "Why, hello, Taylor. Are you still here?" he exclaimed. "What do you think? One of my patients has just come to pay his bill. He's one of the richest patients I've got. He could have paid me by check any time, yet here he is, bringing the money at 10 o'clock on a Saturday night." Hudson laughed. That a man with money should come himself to pay his doctor's bill at such a time was certainly unusual. What had possessed him? People were not usually so punctilious about paying bills. The doctor made his entry in the ledger and started back toward the door when suddenly he turned. "By the way, Taylor," he said, "you might as well take these notes. I have no change, but I can give you the balance of your salary next week. Good night." Hudson, his pockets empty, was left standing in the dispensary with a handful of banknotes. His prayer was answered. Not only could he pay his landlady, not only had he money in hand for weeks ahead, but he had proved again that God answered prayer. There was no question about it now. He could go to China. End of chapter 2.